but he liked anyway, or, but no, what happened? And so I had the idea.
Let's begin by talking about your show here at Moody Gallery in Houston and what inspired these images.
I talked to Betty about doing a show, and she said, well, use the back room. And we talked about various things we do, you know, how I'd use it or what we do. And this solution came down because I wasn't going to put a painting in at first. And she said, you know, I'd really like for you to have a painting in this show too. And I said, well, I'll do a special show. She said, well, you know the wall space. And we worked it out that basically it will be one painting and 10 paperworks somehow about that. So I went away and thought about it, and I said, okay, you know, like what every artist does with each project. And I thought, well, that'd be interesting, so let me see a painting. What shall I do? You know, I've just done a whole series of 99 Cent War about the Iraq War. I don't want to do that again, but I'll do something. So it coincided with reading, actually, Ralph Waldo Emerson, who said, life consists of what we think in a day. So I thought, oh, that's interesting. And I thought about how we're bombarded with images every day in our lives. So what I did, I took a 24-hour period, and I more consciously than normal, set out to record everything I saw in shops, in the street, on television, on a computer, on webs, you know, magazines, newspapers, everything. I just culled everything. I couldn't collect everything because it would have been, you know, thousands of images, because that's what we're bombarded with. But I got a few, and then I got it down to the images, basically, and I editorialized and came down to these images you see in the painting here. And so basically the problem with the painting was to get to somehow organize these very disparate images into a painting. So in this sense, the painting itself is it's just a formal proposition, basically. I mean, I had the choice of picking odd things. You know, I knew that I was going to make a painting, and I knew certain images might work and against each other and with each other. The only image in this painting actually that's actually not in that 24-hour search is the Aladdin's lamp, but I needed that as a device to kind. But so once the painting was done, then I could work on the paperworks. And the paperworks basically take these single images from the painting and then take it further. It's not just a formal question. The paperworks actually, you know, the white building, for instance, in the painting, is a very early building by Frank Gehry, the architect. And I see it a lot, and I walk past it. It's in Los Ageles, it's in Venice. And I photographed it that day. I thought, well, I'll take a photograph. As it happened, I also bought some postcards. So that was, you know, how I went about it. And then, say, in the Frank Gehry piece, so if I take that Frank Gehry building in the paperwork, I've just reversed it. I deconstructed it, and it's called Mad Architect. And you know, the other ones, the footballers, the American footballers with the airplanes, that's called Offensive. You know, and so it's about war, but it's also about, you know, the tactics of football in defense and offense. So you know, each thing went on. This is called Abstract. That's basically taking out everything that's figurative in this painting, and leaving it, because formally the device, it's spiraling, everything's spiraling in that painting. If you look at it, there's absolutely no escape. You're sucked in, you can't get out, hopefully. It's a cat in the painting. That was because I was in Venice, photographed the Frank Gehry building, went into a bookshop, I think it's a bookshop, and bought this postcard. I thought it was a great postcard. So I had to, I'll tell you something else about the cat, but first, so the cat went in, and then came the problem of, you know, what do I do with when I do the paper pieces? And the paper pieces, basically, there's always two things that people say about cats. First, that they don't like water, and the other thing is they're fearless. So I did these, you know, that's what the images are. Cats normally have a fear, or whatever, I can't remember the title now. Cats normally don't like water, which is one title, which is why, you know, the cat's wearing a flippers. I think in America it's called something different. Wedge. What are those things underwater when you put on your feet?
Fins,
rubber fins, yes, and a fishing thing. And the other one is, you know, have no sense of fear, and he's got a whole arsenal there that he's working on. So that's how that came about. But the painting, the reason I didn't paint the cat as detailed as the cat was in the postcard, the cat is in fact in more detail in the paper pieces. But the reason the cat is not in more detail is because of the nature of the painting. And the center figure, that boss, the American footballer who is in silhouette, the American footballer is in silhouette because I went to a great show I had a show in Paris in October, and I went to the Pompidou Center, and there was a huge Dada show on, Dada show, and I saw this marvelous Picabia painting. It was right at the end of a corridor. There was this incredible, and it was just silhouettes. I mean, the figures were silhouettes, and I thought, well, I'll use that. Now, so if that sort of dictated the tone of the painting. Once I'd inserted that silhouette, I couldn't put anything of certain things of a detailed nature in. So that's why I had to make the cat in the painting less elaborate, basically. Yeah. So these are just devices that you use when you make a painting or make any artwork, really. A voodoo doll. In fact, when I was here, when I lived in Houston, every time I used to go to New Orleans, I used to always tell people to go to the Voodoo Museum there. It's a great museum, very small, kind of amateurish, but it's good. And while I was there, I bought some of those voodoo dolls. So not only do I have some, but this actual one came about because of something else. My French dealer just sent me a French magazine in which I had a review of my show in Paris, and I was flicking through this magazine and there was this great image. And I thought, oh, I'm familiar with that because I have three of these myself. I can't tell you who they're the equivalent of and who I stick the pins in. But yeah.
What about the stairwell?
Yeah, the stairwell, because I liked it, and then as I was making the painting, because sometimes paintings make themselves, as I was making the painting, I noticed that, you know, what was happening to the painting as I was organizing it was that it was this whirlwind sort of thing. To reinforce that, I used that particular staircase image. And it's an image that I keep an image bank. Anyway, I have thousands of images. I just throw into files and stuff. And funny enough, I was teaching at the University of Houston yesterday, just for the day, and I was telling one student that I like that image, but more likely it will be an idea. I may have an idea for an artwork, and I may not use it for 10 years, because it's not appropriate, or I can't see in what context I want to use that. And similarly with images. So in fact, that image, probably, I forget what it is. It's probably, that's 10 years ago, I shoved it in a file. And periodically I go through my files and throw things away, because I know that I've lost interest in them. I think I'd better go back. There's a system in England at the time, in the 50s, in which every single child in England had to sit an exam. Every single child that was 11 years and, you know, 1 month, or 10 years and 11 months. And it was called the 11 plus exam. And this was an exam totally unfair. It was, thank goodness it was abolished, where you sat this exam, and if you passed, you went on to grammar school, which is, in fact, you had a continuing academic education. And if you failed, then you went to, trade school, basically. You were learning a trade. And it was basically based on a sort of class system, really, because what happened, of course, is you know, if you're a working class kid, you know, you, that would be the only chance that you get for a continuing academic education after 11. And of course, if you were from any family with any sort of means, you know, middle class family, then if you failed, then you go into private school and you pay. So I sat this exam. I didn't have great expectations. I didn't know if I'd pass. I hope I would. But my father promised me that if I passed, he'd give me a bicycle. I get a bicycle. I thought, oh, this is great. So I sat the exam. It was about 2 weeks later until you get the results, and there's the whole school is assembled, and the names of the successful candidates rang out. You know, it's like, you know, one in six or one in 10. I mean, it's not many. All that many compared to the school. And my name wasn't read out. And I thought, oh, there goes the bicycle. But at 11:30, I was told I had to go and see the headmaster. God, I thought, I'm in trouble, because you never saw the headmaster. And I went to see the headmaster, and it was 11 plus. I was 11 years old. And he said, sit down. And I thought, sit down? He said, of course, you never sat down when you talked to the headmaster. You always stood up. So he sat down. He was very nice to me. And he said, well, Boshier, he said, your name wasn't read out as a successful candidate for the 11 plus to go to grammar school. And I said, no, sir. And he said, well, he said, in fact, he said, your name was on the list, he said, but we thought there'd been a typing error. So that was the start of my education. January 62, it was lunchtime, and I stood at the top of the stairs, just about to go for lunch, down the stairs in the Royal College of Art School of Painting, and I thought to myself, God, I'm going to be leaving here in 4 months. I mean, I'd been a perpetual student. 2 years in there, I told you before, 4 years at undergraduate, 5, 6, 7, 3 years graduate, 7 years, 2 years in the army, 9 years. And now I was going to go out into the world. What was I going to do? So I walked down the stairs, and at the bottom of the stairs, there's a big notice board where everyone's notices are. And it said, scholarships. So I thought, oh, that'll be good. So it said Japan, India, and stuff. And I was interested in the Japan and in India and Japan scholarships. But also at that time, one of my professors had said they'd put me in for a scholarship to come to New York to study at the, oh God, it's a Parsons School of Design. There was they would pay my tuition for a year, which is good. But then I thought, you know, I'd still have to get the airfare together and living expenses. And I thought, you know, I could probably go to America anytime because the language was easy, the same, roughly. And but I couldn't, you know, so I looked into the Japanese scholarships, and you'd had to spend a year and a half before you went to Japan studying Japanese, and languages, I've always been terrible at languages. Then I applied for the Indian scholarship, and I wrote my grant proposal as a study of popular Indian iconography, the art of the streets. So that's what I went to, and I lived in Calcutta for a year, but traveled all over. But I've always tried to combine travel with travel. And I've actually always often made a lot of my work is to do with travel, or if not to do with traveling, the culture of which I traveled to. For instance, in 68, with another artist called Joe Tilson, we were sent on a cultural exchange. And this was 68 in Prague. It's when the Russians were still there, but it was what's called the Soft Revolution. It was called the Dubček Spring. And Czechoslovakia was trying to break away from Russia, that part of the Iron Curtain. And we were there on a cultural exchange to give a lecture, to visit artist studios, and, you know, to have some sort of cultural exchange, of course. And we decided to do something while we were there, we did a project, which we then called an event, which was a happening. I think we didn't want to call it happening, so we called it an event, but basically it was a happening, 1968. And we did something called the Smith Novak event, which you've probably seen on my website. Smith being the most common name in a London telephone directory, Novak being its equivalent in Prague. We went to the British Embassy and Xeroxed all the British ones, got the Prague Embassy, set up a workshop, made banners, walked down the street, got set up a workshop on one Saturday afternoon, I think. We did this workshop in the open in the big square. We produced hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of postcards. And we sent a postcard to an address in London of a Smith. Stuck an image on so that it would have a distinctly Czech feel. And then on the back said, you know, since you cannot wave or smile, we invite you to send a postcard of London to your equivalent in Prague as a friendly act. Here is the address of, and then we put an address of a Mr. and Mrs. Novak so that it could be exchanged. So that was good. So we did something about, that was a Czech exchange. I was asked to do a show in Israel. So I did a show about, and they said, oh, if you've never been to Israel and you're doing a show in this museum, it was in Harod, the museum in Harod, which is a much smaller museum, but it was the first museum ever to be built in Israel. They laid the foundation stones in 1948. And they said, come, because we want you to look at the space to see which rooms you want. And I got there and I chose the smallest room there was. It's about this size, almost exactly this size. And I've done new work for this show. I told you I did new work for the Düsseldorf Sports Show. I said, what shall I do here? So I did a project called Journey Israel Project. So it was a journey, and it was understanding both Jewish and Israeli culture. And you know, it was shown twice in Israel, and shown once so far at the Holocaust Museum here in Houston. But I would like it to be shown in other places. I'm talking to the Jewish Museum in Paris, actually. I work with the Clash. And the reason I work with the Clash was also through art schools and connections. I don't know if you saw this on my website, but basically Joe Strummer of the Clash was in my class. He was in his first year at art school, so he must have been 16 or 17 himself. And he used to sit in my class in the corner and ask everyone to call him Woody. Hey man, call me Woody, man. And that was like same as Bob Dylan because of, you know, Woody Guthrie, and he was interested in Woody Guthrie. And he used to sit in my class in the corner during the breaks with a wooden guitar singing Blowing in the Wind. Blowing in the Wind, you know. But much later, when I was walking down Oxford Street in London, and I saw him walking along towards me. But this time he was all in black, and he had these Doc Martens on, and the fans were screaming behind him. And he was with Paul Simonon, which is his bass player. And they walked along, and I got up to him, and I said, Woody! And he froze. And he said, I remember we were by a shoe shop, and he dragged me into this shoe shop, which was 8 o'clock at night. He said, I'm not called Woody now. And I said, I know you're not. I said, it's a joke. I said, I'm a great fan. I know all your records, you know, Woody. I know all your records, and I'm a great fan. So then less than a week later, I had another phone call from another student who's a good friend and an interesting painter called Caroline Kuhn, who's... And she rang up and said, oh, I hear you met Joe. And I said, oh, yeah, fine. And we talked a bit. And she said, well, would you want to work with them? And I said, what? Well, how do you mean? And you must remember, because you said something about technology. This was 79. There was no MTV. I mean, I tell my students, you know, there was, you know, you've heard of BC before Christ. Well, BMTV. So what pop groups did then, before, because MTV came in at about 81, I think it was 81, and 79, yeah, 80, 81, and 79, so what pop groups used to do, they used to put out songbooks, And it was a continuation from vaudeville or a music hall, where you know you get this for a sheet of music for a penny, and you could play on the piano and read the words of the popular singer of the day from the turn of the century, from 1900. You could play the music hall or vaudeville numbers yourself, and that evolved into songbooks, which rock singers. So that Caroline said to me, would you do, they want you to do their second songbook. And I said, what does that entail? And they said, 48 pages. And they said, what do they want me to do? And they said, they'll just give you the lyrics, because I guess you need to work. And I was using a lot of photography and stuff then, and doing videos and stuff. So that's what I did, basically. When I came to Texas, of course, for my first 2 years in Texas, I was here for 13 years, and from 1980 when I arrived to about 82, I just concentrated on Texas culture. Because I didn't know, and I thought I'd work off of Texas culture, but when it was fresh, before I got to know it too well. And so I researched it, For instance, I didn't think that the cowboy presence was so much here. I didn't think I'd see so many people wearing Stetsons. It sounds funny. And of course, if you go downtown now, today, perhaps I wouldn't see anyone, maybe one or two. But in general, some and certain events, that's there's that great, Kinky Friedberg is here, isn't he, at the moment? Kinky Friedman's here. Running for governor. But he's got a band, right? And his band is unpolitically correct at the moment, called Texas Kinky Friedman and the Texas Jew Boys. And of course, people pick up on this and they say, Texas Jew Boys. And Kinky Friedman always says, but he said Texans and Jews have a lot in common. And people say, what do you mean? And he said, well, think of it. He said, in both cultures, they wear hats indoors and think it's very important. Which is true. Isn't that great? See, I cannot think of another culture. Two cultures that do that. That's so good. So that was good. So when I came here, I did, And it's funny, like, where your work ends up. For instance, one of the first paintings I did here, I don't know if you remember them, is I did a series of naked cowboys. They're naked cowboys, and I did three. One is a shy cowboy. One is the frightened cowboy, and he's standing on a bridge overlooking the 59 freeway, looking down to the Galleria, and he's scared because there's no barrier and he's watching the thing. And the other one was the shy cowboy. He's sort of covering his genitalia with a mask, and he's looking down and pigeon-toed. And the only reason I drew him pigeon-toed is because I'd done mime. And I used to get into these poses. I thought, what's shyness? I got to paint a person with no clothes on, except a Stetson. And at that time, genitalia was going to be revealed. But because the only one I did that genitalia wasn't revealed was the cowboy who held this Mexican mask over his genitalia. But I thought, frightened, that you can get physiological likenesses, and then you can use body language and you can use other things to do things about fear. And shyness, I thought, what happens to shyness? So it's very inward looking, it's like, it's holding yourself. And I looked down at my feet, and my feet were pigeon-toed. I would never have painted that if I hadn't have gone through the pose myself. So there was a shy cowboy, naked cowboy, and then a shy, frightened, and naked cowboy. And I thought, great. And it's a triptych, and I thought, well, that's marvelous. Of all the paintings that I've done, I would like that to stay in Texas. Well, that's in the Tate Gallery in London. And funny enough, it goes the other way. While I was here also, one summer I went to Paris for several weeks, and I decided while I was in Paris, I'd come back here and when I come back to my studio in Houston, I would do a Paris painting. Somewhere I had it in my mind, a fixation. So that's what I did. I went there and I did a painting called the Tuileries Gardens, near the Louvre, all those trees everywhere. In fact, it's a bit like lightning fields, in New Mexico, the lightning fields. Mortimer de Maria, like, because you do just get disorientated actually in the Tuileries Gardens, you can. And so I did this painting that had the Tuileries Gardens things in, like the lightning fields, but I also had some medieval characters, something that I found in the Louvre. And in the right-hand corner, I tried to contemporize one of, Renoir woman. And it so happened, perchance, that just that summer, there was a fashion in Paris for women to wear veils. They were wearing, and it's funny, in the summer and the winter, and the people were, it was like, you know, sometimes you know, short skirts and, you know, white boots, courage boots and something, or next time, but this was a very short season they were. And so I painted that, and she had a plastic umbrella instead of, and she was striding. I got that back and I thought, oh, great, I wonder if Frederica, I'd love to, French dealer to buy that. That's in the Dallas Museum. It works all sorts of ways. Yeah, so traveling's always been a thing. You know, I did the sports thing in Germany. And then I worked off, so for the first 2 years only, actually, was what I worked off of Texas. For the next 8 years, I worked off America generally. That painting that I have in the Menil is called White Robes, it's called White Robes, Black Robes, and Color Television. I think it's in, like a lot of artists work often in collections, in storage, occasionally brought out. I think they never brought it out. But they have a collection. It's one of my favorite paintings I did here. It's about 11 foot long and about 8 foot tall, and it's got curtains on it. That's all it has, is drapes, curtains at each end, and then vast areas of black. And right in the middle is a television that's in color. But the thing on the sides are all black and white. And the patterns on the curtains are the white robes of the Ku Klux Klan and the black robes of the Supreme Court. So it's black and white. You can see the Supreme Court robes and people in them. And this color television with a Ku Klux Klan man. I think it's a Ku Klux Klan man, but he's in color. Instead of white robes, it's like an out of focus TV. It's like sometimes when you get your TV wrong, tunneling. In fact, sometimes I use that. I did a show in Los Angeles, and I thought, apart from what I was doing, actually, you talked about travel and depicting cultures. I did a show in Los Angeles about Los Angeles. So I did, and they were all 6 foot by 5 foot paintings, and each subject within Los Angeles culture I did two things of, i.e. I did two blown up versions of the front page of the LA Times that were appropriate. One was Clinton acquitted, which is great. And then there was another on the other one, and do you know, I picked them by days, what I did. I did drawings first, and I never do drawings usually before painting, but I did a series of drawings that when I got to make these, what am I going to do for my show in LA, I thought, well, I'll do paintings, but, not based on, but based on the idea of depicting in some way or another Los Angeles culture. So I painted Clinton acquitted, which I had. Then I thought, next one I'll do Tuesday week, whatever the color is Tuesday. Come up Tuesday week, front page, he was on the front page of the LA Times, death of pop icon Roy Lichtenstein. So I painted Roy Lichtenstein. In fact, Lichtenstein's wife took an image to look at, and we don't know if they were interested in buying it. I mean, they didn't, but. So, in that way. Oh, the other things I did a whole series too. I was fascinated when art collectors get photographed. They're always, it's the man and wife standing with the house in the background and their sculpture or their collection in it. So I did two paintings in a series called the Los Angeles Art Collectors. And I got the image of the Oscar, and I got an image of one of my favorite things, which there's several good ones of Cycladic art. The Menil here has a beautiful collection of Cycladic art, but so has the LA County. So I did this these two figures standing together, Mr. and Mrs. Oscar Sokladic. But the other coincidence was that in Los Angeles, there are, on public display, there are two Rodins, the thinkers. You know Rodins, the thinkers? Mm-hmm. Well, there are two of those. One is in the Norton Simon, and the other one is in the LA County. And by coincidence, when Batman came out, they produced all the toys that go with the movie, and they had the thinker. And they put him in the Rodin pose, except he had a suit, a green suit with question marks on, and he was called the Riddler, of course. So this is called the Los Angeles Collectors, Mr. and Mrs. Rodin Riddler. I did the Hollywood sign from the British point of view, so it's called Jolly Good. Jolly Good. Yeah. Quite interesting about that. Some British dealer came to my studio and they were inquiring about something else. But they actually bought that and they gave it to, but I had to deliver it. They went back to England. They said, would you mind delivering the painting to the person that, the collector that we, and I think he was, I had to go to, I forget where it was, Warner Brothers or Paramount Pictures. He was a top guy. I had to go to his office. It was like getting into Fort Knox.
What about those book paintings that, the books with the falling computers? And
oh, yeah.
That was
another series. You know, I had another show in Los Angeles, and it's toured one or two places it went. I was interested in a lot of talk about books disappearing because of computers and stuff. And so I did a lot of work about books and computers. It was a similar thing came about. Yes, okay. What happened is this gallery, it's closed, it was called Flowers West. And it was an English gallery that showed British artists in Los Angeles, in Bergamot Station. And they had a... they said, what about doing another show? And I said, okay. They said, well, instead of having the whole gallery, why don't you have the back room? And I said, well, that suit me fine. And do smaller works. I said, yeah, suit me fine. Because I like the idea of doing shows that are like commissions. I mean, I'm not a person that, I do series of works. I mean, I work all the time, but I actually like deadlines. I like deadlines and places. I like to travel, I like to have know where I'm going to show, and I like to do specific shows for specific places. So I thought to myself, well, what am I going to do? And I thought, small works, okay, let me see. I don't know, let me see. Then I had an idea, I know, because I told you sometimes I keep ideas for 10 years. Well, this idea was started about even 20 years ago. And what I'd done over the period of time was I had a file, and every time I read a newspaper or a magazine and I saw something very interesting that had no visual, I thought, well, I threw it in a file, and I got this huge collection of potentially interesting visuals of various descriptions. Maybe a description of it and an explosion. There was one on a description of an explosion. This is 20 years ago, an explosion. And there was no photograph. And I thought, it was an exploding house exploding. And I thought, that'd be good to do it, to make it up from memory. You know, if you were given a house and a photograph of a house and exploding, then all you're doing is copying the photograph of the house exploding. But the most typical ones was this. A 28-year-old man who had been in the IRA, the Irish Republican Army, either called freedom fighters or terrorists, was recalling a story of how at the age of 18 or 17, he was recruited into the IRA. And he said the IRA came to his house, they were all masked, and they sent the mother and his sister out of the room, and they put a Bible on the table, and then they brought out a handgun, and they put a handgun on top of the Bible, and they ask him to put his hand on the top of the Bible and the handgun and swear allegiance. And I thought that was a fantastic image. And so I thought, that's great. So I thought, well, that's great, I'll start these paintings. I have still to this date never found that file. I never found it. But it was the idea of a book. And I thought, well, it'll be a book. And because I'm interested in, you know, this idea of where, you know, computer and information coming in a different way. And so that was that. And so I said, well, I'll do books. And then but I still couldn't remember how I do books. And then I was reading a book at the time, which was supposed to be one of the best biographies of Hitler. And I was reading volume one, and in fact, volume two has still not come out, by an English historian, and for the moment I just forget the name. And I was reading this book, and I got to this amazing chapter when I was just reading the beginning of the chapter, and the phone rang. And I put the book down, and I was on the telephone, and I was looking at the page that I had not yet read. And it was it was all about how Hitler was down and out, and he was living in a men's home. And he was living in, was he living in Munich? Oh God, I can't remember which city he was living in. But he'd been through the war, you know, he'd been through the First World War, and we just actually won medals of distinction because of his bravery in being a messenger. And then it started to talk about what he talked about to people at the men's home. And of course he made watercolors. He was a watercolorist, as you know. And he was encouraged by his Jewish friends to make these watercolors, and he'd sell them, and they were pretty terrible. They were competent. If you looked at them, they are actually competent, but they're to sell to tourists who come to the town, like you'd do the famous historical buildings, and he'd talk about this, and he said he'd go to Munich like a flash to see the great art collections there, because he wanted to get into the art school, the Royal Academy, and they turned him down, of course. Those bloody people, they turned him down. He should talk about the influence of art school on artists, pop musicians and pop. I thought, that's it, I'll just do the open book. And I'll add images. I mean, there's no photograph here, but I can make it out. And so that's what I did. They started off as a series of open books with text, which I did as oil paintings, with acrylic. My next painting, in that series, so all I did as a Hitler painting, I went to the supermarket and saw this great newspaper. You know what are those newspapers they sell at supermarkets? Trash. National Enquirer. It was the National Enquirer. It said, Al-Qaeda breeding killer mosquitoes to invade America. So I did that as a piece. And then I got on to wanting to move on from that, so I did the two. And then I did actual falling books falling, and computers falling out of bookshop shelves, and I did a whole series. So that's how the books came about. And then... Yeah, very colourful, because I hadn't used, you know, because I'd been doing a lot of black and white, so I wanted to try to use colour again. And then I got into, the books, and then I did this series in the books in which there were things I wanted to do, and I realised I could do them in book form. I did this painting, which actually I'm very pleased that what's going to happen. I'll tell you what the painting is. It's something that's been done many times, you know. So many artists have worked off of Picasso's Mademoiselle d'Avignon. But I did it and I just changed the gender. I mean, artists have done it before, but I did it my way. Talking about the early works, how they came about, you know, we didn't, again, I can only talk mostly about what I know, which is the British pop movement. You know, it's like all movements, people are flung together with a label which sort of fits and sort of doesn't, which is why people own and disown the labels. I mean, basically David Hockney's paintings were autobiographical. They were all about him coming out of the closet and being gay and, you know, and doing that. Alan Jones' work looked back to European culture. His paintings came out of Kandinsky and stuff, but then used, instead of being abstract, used popular imagery, you know, double-decker buses, and then, of course, all this fetish, his fetish interests, or fashion. And Peter Blake and Peter Phillips were interested in almost celebratory things, the celebration of the image, of movie stars, and, you know, the celebration, a celebratory nature of decoration and pop culture generally. I mean, Peter Blake has always been interested, and still is, totally up to date with contemporary pop chart culture. So that was that. My own interest came out of the reading of certain books, really about advertising and the manipulation of people. There were Vance Packard's The Hidden Persuaders, Daniel Borstein's The Image, anything by Marshall McLuhan. And those people in the late 50s, in the 50s, were exploring manipulation of people through advertising. But for me, that was interesting via politics too. I mean, I was involved during my years at the Royal College of Art, as were David and many other people, we'd going on the Aldermaston March. They were the anti-nuclear marches. It was a very strong movement in Britain against nuclear power, well, especially a nuclear bomb, you know, devastation it could have brought. So those paintings came out of looking at, you know, the situation of advertising, which is why there's sort of many, many advertising imagery products in the work. I mean, but there were certain images that I used a lot. I was attracted to them, but I could use them as metaphor, which is the Pepsi-Cola sign. Pepsi-Cola was always the idea of the intrusion of American culture onto European culture. I used a pyramid a lot. And the pyramid is always traditionally the symbol of stability. Okay, so these symbols are repeated, and you know they're things that you did as a younger person that you realize that you've done all your life. Like I realized, I mean, some of my 62 paintings, I did a lot of what is now called morphing. You know,
morphing,
which is transforming an image from one kind of context to another. Both as an idea and as a physical object. Metamorphosis is probably the word I used then. But I've noticed that I do it all the time, and one uses that in a way of getting from one to another. But yeah, so it was advertising was very, very strong influence. And political things at the time. One of the earliest paintings I ever did was called Situation in Cuba, which was the American invasion of the Bay of Pigs. And I did, basically it's a Cuban flag, and if you know the Cuban flag, it's stripes and it's got a triangle coming in with a star. In fact, just a bit like the Texas flag, as a matter of fact. And the American flag is eating into it. So it's a taking over of, the Americanization, because most of my early pop paintings were to do with Americanization. England's Glory, for instance, that particular painting, which the image of it is of a matchbox. It was a very popular matchbox at the time. Basically, that ship is called England's Glory, and there it is. And the things that are falling out of it is, if you look closely, that the white image with the red in the center, the red is a map of London. And it's the extent of a nuclear bomb. And the phrase on the blue image, which looks like a comic bubble, is a quote from Nelson, the great British admiral, saying, "England expects every man to do his duty." The other thing is the tie. The stripe thing is an old school tie. And then there's the fashion and the model there. And if you can see, the American flag is eating in to the matchbox of England's Glory. So basically it was the colonization. I was doing referencing the colonization of an early stage of British, Now, for instance, I still keep that up. For instance, I never go to Starbucks here because I refuse to support Starbucks. Because if I travel to Bangkok or Canberra, Australia. I want to see Canberra, Australia, and I don't want to see bloody Starbucks in every corner. So, I mean, there's nothing, I mean, it may seem a sort of diluted, weak political act, but, you know, I just feel that you have to do something. I mean, and then, you know, so those early paintings came out of exploring, you know, commercialism as well as colonization, and but also using popular imagery. I mean, I've used the outline of the AML letter. I always liked that sort of symbol, and I did paintings that were, you know, that was one of the earliest pop paintings I ever did, the AML letter, and that had no figuration in it apart from the AML border of an AML letter, and that's all it was. Because I started off, my early paintings came out of, before I did flags, and I didn't know about Jasper John, you know, one does very quickly, but I had done Situation in Cuba, and I'd used a British flag and the American flag, but the earliest painting I did were sort of almost abstract. They were taking a consumer object like an AML letter, and just, you know, just painting them as though they were almost abstract. The other thing I did at the time, soon after, which was the painting which is now lost, I've no idea where it was. I did a painting called Carl Chessman. And Carl Chessman, as you might remember, so I was working off of, which is what I do now, I was working off current events. I mean, basically, I take all my art, basically, from newspapers and magazines and television, basically. You know, the situation in Cuba at that time was to do with the situation in Cuba, the Bay of Pigs invasion. I also did this painting called Carl Chessman, and Carl Chessman at that time was the person who spent the longest amount of time on death row before he was executed. And I think he was supposed to murder a prostitute in New Orleans. But that was that painting. I've not got it, but I've somewhere in some book there's a black and white reproduction of it. And yeah, they came out of specific things. The other one, the toothpaste imagery, that came out of, I remember how that started, the first time I did that in 62, was I come into college to do a painting, and I had a painting already stretched. Most of my paintings then were exactly the same size. I've worked on a 5-foot by 5-foot paintings. And there'd been a huge campaign in England, everywhere. We were bombarded by it, on hoarding signs, in magazines. And that was that there was the first toothpaste to have stripes in it. Striped toothpaste. And I came into the studio, and I would use that because there was that sense of, you know, I don't know what it was, the toothbrush and the toothpaste, plus falling figures. Oh, it's interesting, I used a lot of falling figures in those early things, because, and they were morphed. Sometimes I'm quite known for morphing figures into jigsaws. I used to use jigsaw puzzles a lot, the image of jigsaw puzzles. I morphed, if you look at these paintings, but this painting is called, I think this painting is about, there's the measurement, I forget what the measurement is. This painting is about 6 foot by 4, but roughly, it may be a little smaller. But this painting is called The Most Handsome Hero of the Cosmos and Mr. Shepherd. It's 1961. And basically, The Most Handsome Hero of the Cosmos was in fact the Russian popular press's name for Yuri Gagarin, who you know is the first person who went in space. And the second person was Mr. Shepherd. And the painting is about the American-Russian space race. Here, for instance, you have the Russian bear. And collaged into this is images of astronauts, both English and American. This is like the American space rocket with another thing, with another astronaut here. Here is some rockets going up. Here is a map of the star system with the Russian bear imposed on it. But here is some American astronauts, and here are the words that Shepard was beamed down, the words that he was talking to NASA, he was speaking. It's 4 a.m. I feel weight consciousness. I am weightless. It is an extraordinary feeling. So the text of their messages were around there too. So that all in all, that painting is actually in Poland, in the museum in Łódź. As I say, because of Grabowski, he bought paint, you know, he actually, he collected paintings early on and had that. This is the only painting, I have some constructed boxes and some paintings, but this is the only painting that I still possess from that period. In 1962, it's called Swan, and again, it was a well-known British matchbox cover at the time, rather like England's Glory was a matchbox cover. These are the falling figures, and this is, curiously enough, almost one of the ones I did that's about art, because what you have is the design and the color of the matchbox transforming into an abstract painting, basically, on this one. I think this is about 6 foot by 2 foot. The other paintings we went through was the 1961 AML envelope painting. This is the one that's in the Tate, the Identikit Man. I mentioned this before, as the campaign when I think it was called Signal Toothpaste, they were putting, but it's to do with manipulation again. And there was another image, the jigsaw image is introduced in that one. I think it was, I can't remember if it was right at the end of the first year of graduate studies or right at the beginning of the second year, we'd all been starting these pot paintings. I'd done these AML letters. This was the AML painting I'm talking about. I'd done that painting. And the faculty said, right, we've got to stop all this pop art nonsense and we'll get back to real painting. So everyone has to stop painting for 2 weeks. And every single student has to do it. And what you have to do is we want you to take a famous painting. That's your choice. And we want you to make a transition. Not a transition. What do they call it? There was a word they used. It's not a copy. Transformation. A transformation. I think they used the word transformation. So we'd not copy it, but we'd take all elements or an S elements. And I remember we all stood around saying, oh, shit. And I remember I was mistaken, but I thought, until recently, I had always told people, when I told this story, that the David Hockney painting that he did, he took from Egyptian art, and he did a famous, very big painting called The Possession, a procession, i.e. walking, of dignitaries painted in the Egyptian style. So those people are all on the side. Now, I'm told by David's most knowledgeable historian, my friend Marco Livingstone, he said, no, you're wrong. In fact, he said the painting that David chose was a Pre-Raphaelite painting called The Last of England. And it was people immigrating with the white cliffs of Dover behind and his family waving goodbye to their family. Now, I chose a William Blake painting, which is of a falling figure. There's a famous Blake figure it's a well. It's a man falling from hell into a well. And I used that. And there's also a series of paintings where people don't morph, actually, but it's as though they're in a test tube. This is William Blake, too. It's like they're in a test tube that winds and whips back like the back of a dog's tail. But that's where I also used the falling figures. So what came out of that was we all said, oh, shit, we don't want to do this. But everyone used it. And it has affected me because I've used it for forever. Yeah.
Even in the David Bowie album cover, right?
One of the things David contacted me because I had done later falling figures too. And yeah. If you look at that cover, by the way, it's a very interesting cover, the Bowie cover. If you look at it, you can see what he's doing. It's as though he's about 4 foot off the ground. No, 3 foot off the ground, and he's falling from a height, and he's falling just past a bathroom sink, a hand basin. And of course, we couldn't do that. We couldn't drop David Bowie from a second floor. So we constructed a table. So what David does is he's on a table like this. He's flying. We built a special table that instead of a huge block, the table leg goes that, the table's that way with legs, and it goes this way, and we built, it goes like this, and we photographed him from above. Yeah, and we put the kitchen sink, and the kitchen wall we put on the floor, and then you get the kitchen sink. And if you look inside the cover, I thought, to make that even more obvious, I thought it'd be intriguing if you were looking at the cover, you'd think, what's he doing? And how did they do that? Did he just fly? So inside I've included a cover of us working on it, of him lying on the table. So it gives the clue away. I like that though, so you see.
Right, and you have that great quote about you would rather provide questions, you're not out to provide answers.
Well, you know, well I think that's to do with the nature of the medium, really. I think, for instance, I often talk in teaching, you know, I think you have to understand the difference between different mediums that are possible to use. I think it's very important to understand the difference between, you know, cinema and you know, art galleries too. I mean, it's, you know, with cinema, at least you've got the audience in their seats for 2.5 hours and they're free to leave. You're free to leave anytime. But theatre, you know, and the difference between that. But the difference also between what's possible within art forms. I mean, within the art form of film and the art form of, say, a painting. And I often illustrate it this way. I said, let's look at probably 7 seconds of a film. Here's the film. I'm going to describe the film for you. Full face, talking head, one woman. She's Eskimo. It's reinforced by the fact that there's a background, if you don't believe it until now. She's a woman, she can see gender, ethnicity, location, you know, but she speaks. Hello, my name is Anuk Katuk. I'm from the Akuda Wu tribe. I have a daughter who's studying to be a doctor in Paris and a son who lives in Argentina. Cut. That's less than 7 seconds. I don't know how many seconds it is. Okay, that's great. Now, we could suspend a bit. We might argue about this. You know, she certainly does look like she's, we understand what a facial character, physiological character of an Eskimo is, and she says she is. She's told us. She's in that snow background, and we recognize that it's not the mountains of Switzerland, it is igloo culture, or whatever it is. And then she adds, but she looks native and tribal. And then she adds she's got a daughter studying medicine in Paris. Well, yeah, why not? You know, people move, you know, she's not. Anyway, that's an awful lot of information. I say to someone, okay, now make a painting of that. I've given you all that information about what you saw in 7 seconds of a film. Make a, you know, now I'm going to give you that, this is the subject matter of your painting. Well, I mean, you can do it. I tell you the person that could do it best is Kitai. I'll be Kitai because of the nature of, he works off of historical things. So, I mean, that's the nature of difference, really. Because I often get students, if you talk for many, many years, there's just these questions that always come up. And one question that always comes up, a student will say, oh, I've got this great idea, but I'm really stuck, I don't know what medium to use, you know, I don't know. And you say, look, what I'm going to tell you may sound stupid, but you should use, just listen, you should use the medium that best suits the idea. I mean, don't make a painting of it if it would make a better documentary film, or don't make a painting of it if it makes a better book, if it's better to be written. You know, if verbal, you know, language is better than visual. I mean, just, you know, think about it.